Hey guys, it's me. Today on the show, the new Democrat mantra, it doesn't matter what things cost. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez doubles down on stupid and a real bionic girl. Stick around.
It's the Rob Carson Show. Are you ready to be pod smacked? Now, here's Rob Carson.
Hello everybody, welcome to the show. Glad to have you here. On this glorious day, as February winds down, my God, spring will be here eventually. How's winter been in your place, in your area? It's been hell here. This has been a really bad winter. I live in the Kansas City area, and it's been a pretty bad winter. It's been bad across the Northeast. It's upper Midwest. Pretty bad winter. So I'll be glad to say goodbye to winter. Today on the show, a whole bunch of stuff. The new Democrat mantra with regard to massive programs like reparations. Reparation is a big thing right now. They want to pay people who are separated 154 years from slavery and ignite a race war in the country, by the way. The Green New Deal, which is just... Green describes these people as far as life experience, I think. That you could create something that over a decade would cost $93 trillion. Just stupid. And would get rid of air travel and cows. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Wealth of material. We have some video from her. Dianne Feinstein takes down some kids at the Capitol who are demanding stuff. They're demanding the Green New Deal. And it is so much to get to. And a bionic girl on the way. These are my t-shirts up here. My t-shirts and my swag. tpublic.com/conservatives. Veganism is an eating disorder. There's Hillary and 20 never. Socialism sucks. All of these things. Tell Bernie Sanders that. He won't believe you. Bernie Sanders thinks socialism is fine. Bernie Sanders is an idiot. And he's also a very, very, very dangerous man. Okay. tpublic.com/conservatives. Just go to tpublic.com. Just type in conservatives. Over 80 designs. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, AOC, as they like to call her, because there's so many syllables. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. 11 syllables. Yeah, better to say AOC. Apparently doesn't live and hasn't lived in the place she calls home. She claims she lives in the Bronx, okay? She spent much of her youth living in upscale Westchester County, in seeming contrast with hard luck campaign biography touting her Bronx roots. After living in the Parchester combo, I guess that's in the Bronx, until she was around age 5, her family moved to a suburban home for better schools. Her father died of cancer in 2008, but retained the ownership of the Bronx condo. Here's the problem. None of the people who live there say that they've ever seen her there. The mailman says letters pile up for months. A nearby taqueria says she's only come over when she's being filmed by news crews. Otherwise, she has nothing to do with the place. Not a big deal for her. Hillary Clinton did it with her Senate Senate seat. Hillary Clinton carpetbagged in New York. So is this a big surprise? Not really. Dianne Feinstein. And the younger generation, they demand a lot of stuff, particularly on campus. Kids are saying, I demand this. I remember Evergreen College a year or two ago. Evergreen College demanded that white professors leave the campus, white students leave the campus for a day. Here's the problem. You're not in a position to demand anything. You're an effing student. Get your asses to your classes. That's my mantra, trademark, Rob Carson. Get your asses to your classes. You have no currency here. You have no skin in the game. Get your asses to your classes. So a bunch of brainwashed elementary students go to Capitol Hill. And I think maybe a couple of them actually wrote the Green New Deal. Because, honestly, it would be embarrassing if it were a high school term paper, if it were a third grade reading and writing assignment due on Friday, and the kid actually just scrambled to get it done as quickly as possible on Thursday night. That's what the Green New Deal is. But these kids decided to go to Capitol Hill and demand of a sitting U.S. senator, and I'm not a fan of Dianne Feinstein by any means, but here they are confronting Dianne Feinstein and the old lady going, ah, nah, not so much, not so much. I think that's actually the paper it was written on.
Ask you to vote yes on the Green New Deal.
Okay, I'll tell you what. We have our own Green New Deal.
Some scientists have said that we have 12 years to turn this around.
What the hell? Who freaking news parents send their kids, their brainwashed brats, to Washington, D.C.? The audacity for a child of this age to demand anything is purely filled by their ignoramus parents. This is honestly, wow. This is puppeteering at its best. Mommy and daddy saying we're going to go to Capitol Hill and demand something.
Well, it's not going to get turned around in 10 years. What we can do.
Grandma's going to get mad.
Senator, if this doesn't get turned around in 10 years, you're looking at the faces of the people who are going to be living with these consequences.
The government is supposed to be for the people and by the people and all
for the people. You know what's interesting about this group is I've been doing this for 30 years. I know what I'm doing. You come in here and you say it has to be my way or the highway. I don't respond.
Wow, Grandma's pissed.
To that. I've gotten elected. I just ran. I was elected.
Well, she didn't actually run. She walked very slowly with a walker.
By almost a million vote plurality. And I know what I'm doing. So, you know, maybe people should listen a little bit.
I hear what you're saying, but we're the people who voted you. You're supposed
to... Now, listen to this. We're the people who voted you. Listen to this.
Listen to us. That's your job.
How old are you?
I'm 16. I can't vote.
Well, you didn't vote for me.
Yeah, you didn't vote for me, you little dimwit.
Well, she voted.
It doesn't matter. We're the ones going to be impacted. It doesn't matter. We're going to be the ones who are impacted.
I understand that.
Like a Mueller.
I have seven grandchildren. I understand it very well.
Senator, the cost of not taking this action is far higher than the cost.
There's the brainwasher in chief there.
Of what the Green New Deal will be.
You're an idiot. The Green Deal hasn't even been written yet. They had a stupid outline that was just, I mean, like I said, third grade writing assignment.
And there is enormous popularity.
You don't even know what's in it, you idiot.
Ready for this bill around the whole country.
You with a bunch of children are going to sway a senator and her vote. Wow.
Here's and we're asking you to be brave and do this for us and for your grandchildren.
Get enough for everybody. I'm trying to do the best I can, which was to write a responsible resolution.
Gonna make your grandmother cry.
Any plan that doesn't take bold, transformative action is not going to be what we need.
Well, you know better than I do. So I think one day you should run for the Senate.
Great, I will.
And then you do it your way.
But by that time,
in the meantime,
by that time, there's going to be a big problem.
I just won a big election.
Wow. Just honestly, wow, wow, wow. I mean, what hubris, what arrogance, what just... Wow. I don't even know what to say. And then there's Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, AOC, who is just box of rocks. Dumb as maybe even dumber. Here she is ripping Dianne Feinstein for doing what for? For a bunch of brats that should be in school and have no effing idea what they're talking about, but mommy and daddy sent them there. Here is Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, essentially picking a fight with Dianne Feinstein. We're not going to go over very well, kids. No.
The issue's gotten worse. So I don't think that working on an issue for 30 years alone is what qualifies.
Okay, so Dianne Feinstein has been working on an issue for 30 years, and that doesn't qualify her to have anything. And no, a waitress who just got elected by a very small plurality by accident, who lied about where she lived, she has a much better understanding of environmental science.
As is what makes someone qualified to solve an issue. That said, There are a lot of people that have been doing this work for decades, that have proposed ambitious solutions for years, and have not been listened to.
Because they're all a bunch of socialists, and all communists, and liars. And they make this shit up so they can control more of your life. That's what this climate change bullcrap is. All it is to bring down the United States. It's not to raise boats of other countries. It is just to bring us down because we are a big, selfish, greedy, awful country with billionaires who are evil. She's picking a fight she's not going to be able to complete. She is picking a fight that she is not going to be able to complete. And she is going to get her ass handed to her in the midterm. She's going to, in her next election, 2 years from now, my prediction, she's going to be voted out of office. She already effed the Amazon deal, costing 25,000 jobs and $30 billion to Queens, New York. Could have changed the lives of thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Business owners nearby who invested millions. She is gone. She is one and gone. And she should be, because she's an idiot. I heard Rush. Rush was talking about how she is ignorant. Wasn't really willing to commit to stupid. No, I'm willing to commit to stupid. She is stupid. All right. She believed that the tax breaks given to Amazon to bring their facility to the Bronx, or to Brooklyn. $3 billion in taxes, said that if we they don't come here, we get to take that money, we spend it on infrastructure. There's no money. And now there's really no money. There was no $3 billion in pallets like Barack Obama sent to Iran in a cargo plane. Nothing like that. The money is not there. It exists in the ether. It is tax credits to get the business there. But she's so stupid, not ignorant, stupid to figure it out. Oh, here she is. She says, talking about, I got a couple other bites for her. Oh, yeah. You shouldn't have any children. This is another thing. So if you don't abort the babies before birth, just don't have them. Or if you decide to, a botched abortion, the baby survives, kill it. Or just not have kids altogether. This sounds very Mao. Because that's what they do. It's called eugenics. And this is essentially what she is promoting. And this ultimately would end up in, like it has in China and Germany, a forced sterilization. And it always starts out little baby steps. Ooh, sorry, that was a bad way to put it. Little baby steps. And so she's saying, you know what, maybe our duty is to not have children. And you know what I'm going to say? You go first, girlfriend, because the world's going to be a lot better if you don't have children.
Our planet is going to fit disaster if we don't turn this ship around.
Our planet is going to think disaster. You see all the little hearts and crap there on the bottom of the page? Here, right there. That's people who actually agree with her, and they're stupid too.
And so it's basically like there's scientific consensus that the lives of children are going to be very difficult.
Wow. Give her credit. Consensus. A three-syllable word. That's big for her.
And it does lead, I think, young people to have a legitimate question.
Is she up talking? I think she's kind of up talking a little bit there.
Is it okay to still have children?
Is she having chicken nuggets and maybe some mac and cheese? Is it still okay to have children? Listen to that again.
Is it okay to still have children? And
what a sick, psychotic.
I mean, not just financially, because.
Oh, it might be french fries and chicken nuggets.
People are graduating with 20, 30. 100.
She's a big girl. She wouldn't got a happy meal.
$100,000 worth of student loan debt. And so they can't even afford to have.
And I guess she burned them. She's putting them in the trash.
In a house, but also just this basic moral question, like, what do we do? And even if you don't have kids, there are still children here in the world, and we have a moral obligation to them.
What in the hell are you talking about?
And this idea that if we just, I've been working
on this for a carrot.
Amount of years.
Could be jicama.
Like not good enough.
Like, I think it's jicama.
A universal sense of urgency.
Now she's just descended, well, even worse, into gobbledygook, into faculty lounge mental masturbation.
And people are trying to, like, introduce watered down proposals that are frankly going to kill us.
Oh, dear God.
A lack of urgency is going to kill us. It doesn't matter.
I'm getting dumber. I'm actually losing IQ points every moment that I watch her.
If you agree that climate change is an important issue, at this point, it doesn't matter. If you believe climate change is a problem.
I want to go watch Grace and Frankie now and find it really entertaining.
That's not even.
I'm really getting stupid.
The issue. It's.
Wow. Oh, there's a low battery.
The issue is how urgently you feel we need to fix it. And if you do not have a sense of urgency to try to turn this around in 10 years, how is that different than a person who's just.
Man, her technique is really terrible. I mean, she does not know how to cook. Wow. That's just the cook in me. Let's talk real quick about a sponsor of the show. These are the best pretzels in the history of mankind. And I'm not saying it. Dots pretzels are incredible. Dots pretzels are absolutely incredible. They are buttery. They are garlicky. They're a little salty. They're a little spicy. They're a little oniony. They are the best dang pretzels in the world. I've got some in a cabinet in the other room. My wife gets them at her work, and they are absolutely fantastic. And you can order them online, dotspretzels.com. It's right there. If you live in the Midwest, like the heart of the Midwest, Iowa, South Dakota, North Dakota, Missouri, Kansas, you can get them readily. They're also in Arizona now. They got a plant in Arizona. They're the best pretzels ever. They are the best pretzels ever. You don't want to put mustard on them, all that crap. Just leave them alone. And just when you open the bag of pretzels and you pour them in a bowl and you're watching movie night, it is so good. They are so good. DotsPretzels.com. If you go online, order, you know, make a note. Say, hey, Rob Carson told me to buy these things. Because they're just the best. They are just the best. All right, let's get back to a little bit of stupid. I mean, Ocasio-Cortez, shall we? Talk a little bit more about, Ocasio-Cortez. Oh, here she is saying that we need to stop eating beef because of cow farts. This is good.
I think that's a reference to your Green New Deal. Yes. Can you explain that for us?
Yes.
In the deal, what we talk about is,
can you explain that to us? I'm sorry, I'm a grammar Nazi.
It's true, is that we need to take a look at factory farming. Mm-hmm. You know, period. It's wild.
Yeah.
And so but
factory farming is wild. Here's the deal. We've got a lot of people to feed. We've got a lot of people to feed. And does factory farming suck? Yeah, to some degree it does. But we've got a lot of people to feed. And so there are companies, and I'm a small farmer advocate. I grew up in the Midwest. My father had an acreage, and we raised our own produce and everything. But there is a place for factory farming. Like there is a place for making Twinkies in a factory. We've got to eat. We've got to eat. That's just the way it is. And you, my dear, although you look like you could use a sandwich, you need to eat too.
Say you get rid of agriculture. It's not to say we're going to force everybody to go vegan or anything crazy like that. But it's
but you'd like it.
To say, listen, we got to address factors.
So you could sit there and uncomfortably and very poor technique, cut some sort of vegetable like you did in the last video clip.
Farming. Maybe we shouldn't be eating a hamburger for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Like, let's keep it real.
Down.
Yeah, I mean,
who's eating in a burger and breakfast, lunch, and dinner?
But we have to take a look at everything, and what we need to realize is that climate change is about every choice that we make in our lives. You know,
really, every choice. Okay, so I see a penny on the ground. I'm gonna pick it up. Climate change.
When you say climate change.
Tonight, my wife and I are going to go out to dinner at a small Italian restaurant near our house. Climate change.
What are you talking about? It was cold yesterday, now it's
cold. I'm going to mow the yard today. Climate change.
Tomorrow. It's the same thing. Okay,
so all right, enough without that. Why are you trying to take all our money away from us? We just signed the Showtime, and now you're trying to put the wild tax on billionaires. What's wrong with you?
No, seriously. Okay, there you go. I don't know that song, or that show, DeSeuss and Murrow, whatever. I don't know. They might be kind of good. I don't know. I don't have a Showtime show. I've got a home studio. I'm not actually in front of Washington, D.C. I'm not hovering against, above the capital of the United States. But I know. It's disappointing. Someday, maybe. Someday. let's see here. Cortez. Oh, talking about Republicans and not voting for climate change. Why should they worry about it? They're going to be dead before too long. Here's a little bit more of this, and then we're going to move on to some other stuff.
I'm not, you know, I'm 29, and I know that this is going to be the world that we're going to have to deal with, that we're going to have to live in. And with all due respect to my colleagues, but especially in, like, the Republican Party, it's like, you're not going to have to live with this problem. You're just, I'm sorry.
I.e., you're like, too old.
I mean, but seriously, and it's not.
Okay, you're going to be dead. Okay. So, you know, because you're going to die sooner, well, you know, maybe, that Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, because you are going to die sooner than her chronologically, if you look at the law of averages, yes, you have nothing to say. That's what it means. That's ageism, people. That's ageism. Yeah. Oh, it's alive and well in radio, by the way. Okay. What do we got here? Kamala Harris. Kamala Harris is, running for president. Dingbat. Leftist. Talking about the Green New Deal and all of these programs, reparations, another thing that the Democrats are touting. And this is going to end up in the death of the Democrat Party, I hope. Because the country is not buying into it. The country is not buying into socialized medicine. The country is not buying into killing babies while they're being born or after they're born. The country is not into socialism. It's not. Thank God. Thank God it's not into that. But I want them to keep whistling down this pathway, because it's going to mean their loss in 2020. Here's Kamala Harris talking about, how it's not important. It's not important how much things cost and how we pay for them.
You cast yourself on the campaign trail as a truth seller. You say we need to tell truth.
Truth teller.
What do you say, or tell me if you think this is fair, that as you talk to Democratic voters, they're hungry. Mm-hmm. And they want ideas. Mm-hmm. And so you'll hear things like the Green New Deal.
And they have no ideas. They have, and I've told you this before, infrastructure, higher minimum wage, okay? The operative phrase in minimum wage is minimum. And now the Green New Deal, which is, it harkens to a policy from 80 years ago, where it creates work, it doesn't create jobs, and where is the money going to come from? Nobody knows where $93 trillion, that's $9.3 trillion a year over a decade, which is twice the nation's GDP.
Things like Medicare for all. You hear things like, whether it's...
Where's it going to come?
You'll hear things... Right. At what point do you say, that's our North Star, but we have to be realists?
There's no question.
Which would be the opposite of being a Democrat right now.
You have to be practical. But being...
Opposite of being a Democrat right now.
Being practical also recognizes that climate change is an existential threat.
I believe AOC said that the other day. So these are talking about an existential threat. I doubt that they even know what existential means.
To us as human beings. Being practical recognizes that greenhouse gas emissions are threatening our air and threatening the planet.
I just emitted a greenhouse gas. There's another thing I could do. No, I'm not going to.
And that it is well within our capacity.
Small studio.
Human beings.
Not a good idea.
To change our behaviors.
It's like an elevator.
In a way that we can reduce its effects. That's practical.
Can we afford it?
Of course we can afford it.
$2.5-3 trillion a year for
medical. $22 trillion in debt. We put it on the credit card.
Care for all by some studies. Depending on which portions of the Green New Deal you pick to do first, that's money. That you know what the Republicans are going to say, tax and spend liberals, pie in the sky.
One of the things that I admire and respect is the measurement that is captured in three letters, ROI. Mm-hmm. What's the return on the investment? People in the private sector understand this really well. It's not about a cost, it's about an investment. And then the
government doesn't invest in anything.
Question should be, is
nothing the government does increases in value.
It worth the cost in terms of the investment potential. Are we going to get back more than we put in?
So and we won't. And it's not possible. It's not possible for government to do anything that comes back with a mean increase in value. It's not possible.
Bloomberg, Amy Klobuchar, some of your potential fellows.
Government doesn't build anything. The government spends money.
Democrats say, no, it's too much, it's too ambitious, it's too expensive. you think they're wrong.
It's not ambitious. It's idiotic.
I look forward to that debate on the debate stage. I look forward to it
very much. Yeah, I can't wait. A little smile there. She just, I look forward to that. Oh, so do I. I also look forward to you being beaten in 2020. Mm-hmm. Oh, here she is doubling down on the, we don't have any money, but that's okay.
I've been having conversations with a certain style of Democrat that would brand themselves as pragmatic.
This is so faculty lounge, mental masturbation.
And what they say to me is...
So very NPR.
Is, you know, it's a wonderful ideal to think that we can get to a place in this country where we have universal health care or universal education.
Mm-hmm. And we take care of those who don't have health care, and the rest of us who can afford it, we buy our own.
I'll say something like, practically speaking, we could never do that.
Are you going to get to the question here in a second?
Although we are one of the last industrialized countries in the developed world to not offer affordable health care to its citizens.
We do!
So what do you say, how do we get to a point where we change the conversation? How do we have that cultural change so that people understand that this can be done?
Right.
And then what's your plan for, they want to know how you pay for it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
How do you talk to those Democrats that look at some of these ideals with skepticism?
My God, will this question ever end?
I would say to them that that we have to reframe the perspective, and instead of looking at the issue of ensuring that all people have access to health care, because the premise there is that access to affordable health care should not be a privilege, it should be a right. It should not only be accessible to those who can afford it.
Oh, there's
it,
the applause line. There you go.
Yeah. So then when people start saying cost, 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 my response is no. It's not about cost.
Yeah,
it's about investment.
It's not about investment.
It's about investment. You know,
wow. They know nothing about investment. Democrats know nothing about investment. Government doesn't invest in anything. The government just spends money. And they usually do it in a really lousy way. This is priceless. Listen to this. You know, I got these migrant caravans coming to the United States. And this started with DACA, PACA, the attempted at PACA, parents of illegals, whatever, during the Obama administration. So this is policy. The only reason why so many people are streaming north from places like Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, Nicaragua, is because of policy that started during the Obama administration. It was broadcast to people there. Come here. We'll let you in. Bring your kids first. Then we'll pass PACA for parents. And then 26 Republican governors said, no, we're not going to allow that. So you had all these kids who came here, many of them sex trafficked, basically delivered throughout the United States via bus, via, you know, airfare, disappearing into the fabric of society, mom and dad still at home, and the chain migration that could have happened with their family never did, thankfully. That's where it all started. But Al Gore is saying that the real national emergency is climate change. And the related droughts in Central America, which he claims are to blame for the migrant caravans bound for the U.S. This is great. Al Gore issued a chilling warning. Now, 20 years ago, he said New York was going to be underwater, I believe. He says if you want a definite ranking of the most serious emergencies we're facing, there's no doubt in my mind that the climate crisis is number one on the list. I'd sure like a massage with a happy ending. Here's the problem. Places like, he says there's a dry corridor. Insert Hillary Clinton joke here. A dry corridor spanning an area that covers parts of Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras, and Nicaragua. And that's the reason why they're coming here. The drought becomes unbearable, so they have to pick up stakes and they say, we can't live here. You know, no, it's because those countries suck. It's because they suck. All of those countries suck major, you know what. They're awful. They are awful. They are like Venezuela. They are awful. They haven't been able to get their crap together for centuries. They're still third world hellholes. And the reason they're coming to the United States is because they want to have a job. They want to be, instead of in Caracas, Venezuela, well, the number one restaurant in the city is the zoo. They're coming here. This is not climate refugees. As Al Gore says, there could be as many as 1 billion climate refugees migrating across borders to other countries. That's a threat to political stability and peace. Not the best Al Gore. I'm sorry. I can do a Bill Clinton. You know, Bill Clinton's pretty easy to do. You want to talk about a dry corridor? Talking about my wife. Yeah. Okay. It's because those countries suck. That's all. It's not because of a dry corridor. It's because they all suck. And the socialist left-leaning governments of those countries have made it suck. So instead of becoming more like the United States, they just let their people leave. And they do. And then the United States government encourages them to come here. Jennifer Rubin on MSNBC says that voters want centrism. And that's the Democrat Party. Jennifer Rubin, you're high.
Gold Bond Crack Skin Relief.
Oh, there's my Gold Bond commercial. Whatever.
Jennifer Rubin, another one of your pieces yesterday, one of like seven, was on how Democratic voters aren't where a lot of Democratic candidates are. Explain that and also how important...
Because the Democrat candidates want babies to be killed after they're born. Yeah. And they want... government health care, and they want socialism.
Is it to Democratic voters that the candidate can beat Trump?
It's very important. Over and over again, they say beating Trump is more important than having a candidate who aligns with their views perfectly or even mostly.
If Hitler can beat Trump, then I'm voting for him.
I think what we have gotten in the habit of doing is focusing on, obviously, the loudest, most exciting voices in the Democratic Party these days. People like AOC, people like Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, who are quite...
I got some video from Bernie Sanders in just a couple of minutes in 1985 praising... socialism. By the way, he took his wife on their honeymoon to the Soviet Union. I wonder if they walked hand in hand over the mass graves of Stalin.
Progressive, but in fact,
went to a gulag, had a nice candlelight dinner.
Look at the results in 2016. What Democrats did was they chose moderate Democrats in those primaries, and it was those moderate Democrats who went on to win and ultimately deliver a House majority.
Then why have they gone so bat crap crazy to the left, Jennifer Rubin? If that's what got them into office, why are they going so bat crap to the left? And don't say that they haven't gone there, because they are going there in a full-throated way.
To the Democrats, there wasn't a single Bernie-endorsed candidate who actually flipped a Republican-held seat. There were a slew of Democrats who were from the moderate faction of the party that did that. And when you
Is there a moderate faction of the party? I mean, seriously, really?
Look at a lot of the recent polling, Pew, Gallup. What you see is that a majority of the party wants the party to be more centrist. If you look at Republicans, they want it to be more conservative. So if you want to...
Really? Really? Fiscally? Sure. But there are a lot of things that many Republicans are embracing that are not traditional. And I'm not talking about, like, listen, I'm pro-life. I'm pro-life. That's it, right? I'm pro-small government. I'm pro-military. Get the government out of marriage. Gay people want to get married. Who cares? Maybe that's the libertarian me, but I do believe that people, Generation X, which you never heard talked about. You never hear Generation X talked about. I'm a Generation Xer. Nobody has ever spoken about Gen X. We just kind of got out of college, went to our jobs, and now we're, you know, getting a few years away from retirement. Nobody ever talks about Generation X. Very successful generation. Very successful generation, but nobody ever talks about them. That's a little off track. But anyway, a little bit more from Jennifer Rubin.
Party that is moving closer to the center, or whose voters say they want to be closer to the center, that would be the Democrats.
This is why they're going to lose in 2020, because if their voter want them to move to the center, AOC is certainly not that, and Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren and Kamala Harris, these aren't people who are moving towards the center. They are going left, left, left.
So what you have now is you have a whole slew of quite progressive candidates, and you don't have very many candidates. You have Amy Klobuchar, maybe you'll have Joe Biden, who are appealing to that very large swath of Democrats who consider themselves to be moderate and really want to win this election.
And the Democrats are going to lose it because of that major move to the left. George Ramos talked to Maduro of Venezuela, and he didn't like the questions that Mr. Jorge Ramos was asking, and they detained him. We'll get to that. Oh, the real life bionic girl. That's kind of a cool story. Kind of a cool story. Oh, Bernie Sanders, who tells us that you shouldn't fly in private jets and you should have poison light bulbs in your house and you should drive an unsafe car. And he owns three houses and rents another one. Apparently, according to six sources that talked to the Politico in the final months of the campaign of 2016, Bernie Sanders demanded private jets to stump for Hillary Clinton. I'm not shocked that while thousands of volunteers brave the heat and cold to knock on doors until their fingers bled in a desperate effort to stop Donald Trump, His Royal Majesty King Bernie would only deign to leave his plush D.C. office or his brand new second home on the lake if he was flown around on a cushy private jet like a billionaire master of the universe. According to Zach Petkanis, who is a director of rapid response for the Clinton campaign. Sanders' flights, usually on Gulfstream planes, cost the Clinton campaign cost about $100,000 in total, according to three people familiar with the cost of air travel. We would try to fight as much as possible because of the cost and availability of planes, but they wouldn't request a private jet every time. We would always try to push for commercial at the campaign. You're constantly trying to save 25 cents. But apparently was so common for Sanders to request private jets became a running joke in the office. But he's a typical kleptocrat. He's a typical Democrat. He's a typical proletariat. And you are the bourgeois. Now, campaign manager, former deputy campaign manager Renia Batrice said the flights were necessary because of the intense schedule the Clinton campaign asked Sanders to keep in the final months. Other Clinton surrogates who got chartered jets for campaign appearances, Beyonce, Jay-Z, Katy Perry. And then this old, probably smells like mothball, white-haired, professorial douche. Sanders routinely badmouths billionaires in their high-flying lifestyles, yachts, private jets, helipads, have become symbols of people with all the unnecessarily large carbon footprint, and yet, when it comes to politics, he's willing to apply a different standard. That's the way the proletariat works. The important people never really expect to live by the rules they want to set for others. Sanders and his people clearly know this is a touchy issue, which is why there are no photos or video from any of these flights. You live by a different standard. That's just the way it works. That's just the way it works. Here's Bernie Sanders in 1985.
I think what I learned, one of the things that I think I learned on my trip, you know, as a socialist, the word socialism does not.
This is on his trip to the Soviet Union for his honeymoon. Okay. Stalin killed 60 million people. Okay. Stalin killed 60 million people. Communism killed millions and millions and millions and millions more.
Right. And I think it's probably fair to say that the Nicaraguan government is primarily a socialist government. You may recall way back in, when was it, 1961, they invaded Cuba. And everybody was totally convinced that Castro was the worst guy in the world, that all the Cuban people were going to rise up in rebellion against Fidel Castro. Well, they forgot that
can't rise up if he kills everybody.
Educated their kids, gave them health care, totally transformed the society. But just because Ronald Reagan dislikes these people does not mean to say that the people in their own nations feel the same way.
How do you find the sincerity?
They're forced to feel that way. They can't speak out against the government. They go to jail. There are 160 political prisons on the tiny isle of Cuba. You idiot.
Sandinista leaders.
I was impressed. I was impressed by Father Descoto because he is a very gentle, very loving man. Ortega is an impressive guy. Ernesto Cardenal.
Listen, this is Nicaragua, not the Soviet Union. I apologize.
He's a funny looking guy. He's gray hair. And he really does remind you of a hippie.
Did you have suggestions for them how they could organize their PR a little bit more effectively?
I think it's yes.
Maybe not kill so many people would be one thing. Just saying, if you want to do the PR thing, probably not arresting the opposition and killing people and putting them in the political prisons. And then you could also like give out free cookies.
I mean, I, the point that I try to make to many of the people that I spoke to is they're getting killed in the American media. Mm-hmm. They just cannot compete. Reagan and his people are so sophisticated. They own the airwaves, of course. Reagan, the media, every time.
This is like before Rush Limbaugh. How is that possible?
Reagan gives them a photo opportunity. Thousands. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you very much for telling us another lie. You know, the media, of course, is not allowed to ask sharp questions of the president. That's not allowed.
Wow. He really hasn't changed much, has he? His teeth are a little yellower. Oh, Jorge Ramos. So he goes and he goes to talk to, and by the way, Bernie Sanders refuses to call Maduro, the president of Venezuela, a dictator. He says there are still democratic things happening there, even though the last election was stolen by Maduro. Jorge Ramos decides to do an interview with Nicolas Maduro, the successor of Hugo Chavez. Hugo Chavez's daughter is the richest person in Venezuela, not in Venezuela anymore. She's worth $1 billion. Where'd that money come from? Did she build something? Did she create a great product? Nah. Daddy stole the money. Daddy stole the money. And that's what happens when you have the bourgeoisie and the proletariat and the ruling class and the rest of you poor people. Did you realize in Chicago, middle class is disappearing? Same goes for San Francisco. Same goes for New York. These are all liberal bastions. So there are a select few who are plugged in. A lot of government types. And then the scraps are thrown to the people, to the bourgeois. Here is Jorge Ramos talking about how he interviewed Nicolas Maduro, and apparently he showed Maduro some footage of Venezuelan people eating out of a garbage truck because they're still starving to death. And Maduro didn't like it. And suddenly Jorge Ramos has to realize that the person that he has idolized as a radical leftist, maybe not that good a guy.
So it is Monday night. We are already at the hotel in Caracas, Venezuela.
Caracas, Venezuela.
What happened is that I conducted an interview with Nicolás Maduro. I asked him if I can call him either a president or a dictator, because, as you know, millions of Venezuelans don't consider him a president.
Because he stole the election.
And we...
And he kills people in the opposition.
Because... the fraud that happened here in May 2018. Also the reports of torture and...
The whole torture thing. God, they still do that torture thing over there. Wow.
Human rights abuses.
That's socialist. Greatest hits, everybody. Torture. Murder. Silencing political opposition. All available on this KTAL album of The Best of Socialism and Communism.
Political prisoners.
Call now.
And at the end, I showed him a video that I personally took last Sunday of three kids behind a trash truck looking for food.
No, that's a Venezuelan food truck. That's a Venezuelan food truck. It's like, oh, hey, there come the guy. Here comes the garbage. I mean, the food truck. That is a Venezuelan food truck. Is what we would call a garbage truck. Wow, what a success story.
And he just couldn't stand it. He didn't want to continue the interview. He tried to close my iPad where I showed him the video. And then nice. He said the interview was over. It was about 17 minutes of interview. After that, their Minister of Communications, Jorge Rodriguez, told us that they didn't authorize the interview and they confiscated all our cameras, four cameras.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All our video.
That's what they do.
All our cell phones.
Yes. Nice.
And we were thrown out of the presidential palace. But
this is what dictators do, Jorge.
Before I left the palace, they took me into a security room with producer Maria Guzman, and they asked for our cell phones. And I didn't want to give them my cell phone.
You didn't end up in a gulag, and you didn't get gassed or shot to death. So, you know, that's a victory in Venezuela.
So they turn off the lights.
Let's go to the garbage truck and have some dinner tonight, shall we?
At the hotel in Caracas, Venezuela. And what happened is that...
So, Jorge got arrested, had his cell phone taken away, his laptops, all of his cameras and everything. But he did escape with his life, which is kind of a big deal in Venezuela. 3 million people have left Venezuela. And this doofus is a leftist. He is a leftist. Welcome to it, man. Sucks. It sucks to be you. It sucks to be you. Nebraska State Senator Ernie Chambers. I grew up in near Omaha, and Ernie Chambers has been in the unicameral in Nebraska for his entire life. Okay? His entire life he's been there. In the 70s, he was the only senator to wear a sleeveless sweatshirt. He'd cut the arms off because he was down with the struggle, even though he has not struggled ever in his life. I mean, he's been in the unicameral for 40 plus years. Here he is talking about the American flag. You might, if you're on a blood pressure medication, you might want to pop one right now. Just a glass of water, pop that sucker right in there, and listen to the hate of an old radical guy who has a chip on his shoulder the size of the state of Nebraska, Ernie Chambers.
Senator Groney wants to talk about the meaning of respect. What do white people mean by it, and what do black people mean by it? White people mean we got to bow down to what they tell us as black people to bow down to. I don't come up here for this rag every day, and it's a rag. That's all it is to me.
You are an a-hole supreme. The American flag is a rag to you. Well, go effing live in Cuba, you shriveled up old douchebag.
When you show a way to persuade Jews to sanctify
he's getting all Perica now.
When you show me that, I'll come up here and stand while you all hypocritically pretend that rag is something that it definitely is not.
Go survive in the private sector, you old douchebag. Here is a little exchange from MSNBC about the possibility of reparations. DeRoy Murdoch is in this piece, and another dude. Let's go ahead and listen to it. Or watch it,
I should say. Some 2020 Democratic candidates are touting their support for reparations for slavery. Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren, and Julian Castro have all gotten on board with the idea. But before we all jump on a bandwagon, let's take a look at what the actual cost could be using Pickford payouts to black farmers under the Obama administration. Of course, they were discriminated against by the USDA. Each were given $50,000. It was awarded to over 33,000 farmers or their heirs. So if we apply that same model right now to every black American and people of multicultural who say they have black descendants, then we're talking
$50,000 per person. I got my ancestry DNA. I could be 2,020th African-American. I could be. Elizabeth Warren, 2,020th Native American, which is, I'm more ostrich than that. So maybe, would I qualify for a check?
About $2.5 trillion. Joining me now to debate, Fox News contributor.
Per black person.
And hashtag Roland Martin, unfiltered host Roland Martin. Roland, let me start with you.
Here's Roland.
I'm kind of surprised that three Democratic candidates have jumped on board with this as a central issue already. What do you make of it?
Well, first, we make the mistake by trying to automatically jump to the cost as to understanding why you're even having the conversation. When you talk about this year commemorating the 400th anniversary of 20-odd Africans arriving.
His head is shaped like a D-sized battery.
Virginia in 1619, you have to look at American history to understand that it goes
looks
back.
Looks like a cookie jar on his head.
Back to General Sherman and Special Order 15, 40 acres and a mule that was rescinded.
Yeah, it was 154 years ago.
By after Lincoln was killed. There was an effort to distribute land to freed slaves that was never passed by Congress. This nation has always used the free labor of African Americans to build the country, but has never dealt with the reality.
There are a lot of other people who built the country too, actually. There's a lot of white people and a lot of Irish people and Chinese people who built the country too.
Of preventing black folks being a part of the economic system in this country. Those are facts.
Roy? Well, here's a fact. Slavery ended 154 years ago.
Ding, 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 ding.
It's been a long, long time since we had slavery in this country. And you have people who've come to this country, let's say the great wave of immigrants who came around 1890, 1900. I think they're going to be really shocked and disgusted if this thing goes through. And you have people who may have come from Poland or Russia or Ireland, and they suddenly have got to pay money to the progeny.
They weren't here during slavery.
People who have not been enslaved for 150.
Most of us weren't.
50-odd years, and you have people like my family. I'm black, but my family came to the United States in 1962. My parents are from Costa Rica. Do I get a check? We had no role in American slavery.
What do you say, Charles? One second, Roland, I'll let you in, but I do want to ask, what do you say to the folks that says it just wasn't when slavery ended, though? The Jim Crow laws?
Yeah, the Jim Crow laws, Democrat policies, by the way. No, it just doesn't happen. This will, if it does pass, and it's absurd, because let's look at any oppressed group in the history of the United States of America, Irish people, Chinese people. Why would you pay their relatives who live now when their relatives are separated by 154 years? And when was the last time a government check ever solved much of anything? All right? When was the last time a government check really did it for you? I got a couple other things I was going to get to. I don't think I'm going to. I've got a story that I want to share. I want to share the Bionic Girl story next, because that's kind of positive. That's real positive, actually. The Bionic Girl story. I had a little bit of Jussie Smollett. Do you know Jussie Smollett? That story disappeared pretty quickly because the left realized it was so, so wrong to support this guy. Robin Roberts said, hey, you know, maybe there were some red flags. Yeah, well, we all saw them because it was a joke. It was a joke. I'll go ahead and play Cornel West. He's a Harvard professor, and he's an idiot. No, he's not an idiot. He's just crusty and awful and intellectually bankrupt. Here he is talking about Jussie Smollett. Jussie Smollett could be the drugs. Could be the drugs.
Accountability that people are calling for. Well, that's certainly true. The superintendent, who was interesting for the Chicago police yesterday, talked about how, as a black man, he was left asking why would anyone, especially an African-American man, use the symbolism of a noose to make false accusation if that is, in fact, what happened?
Because this is what is being perpetuated by the left on college campuses around the country, that it's 1968 all over again, even though this Harvard-privileged black man is suddenly claiming victim, even though he's never been a victim in his life.
Yeah. You know, I also tenured professor. Want to keep in mind that I think Brother Smollett has a drug problem. And so
Brother
he might
Smollett.
Not be in full control. He still has to be accountable, but might not be in full control.
Yeah, well, he's still got to be accountable, but he's not in control.
The same way, you think his precious mother, Joanne, taking him to the church and teaching him music. He couldn't read, he couldn't write.
And then he got all molested with children.
But produces this magnificent music. Lula, his first girlfriend, who dies drowning in his eyes. The wounds are so deep. But the fundamental question always is, will you be a wounded herder or be a wounded healer? And if you're wounded, as is the case, it seems to me, with Smollett, as is the case with R. Kelly, might be the case with Robert Kraft. I don't know his life. But the question is, whatever wounds you have, will you choose to be a healer or will you choose to be a herder? And if your wounds are simply going to be those that produce wounds, that's the choice. And if you're wounding others, especially precious girls and black girls, I mean, my God, you know, the value.
You're leaning out of the phrase there, buddy. Kind of.
In this society is one in which our precious black sisters, especially under 15, are always overlooked, always downplayed. And so when you engage in that kind of violation, oh my God, this is sinful, capital S, if I can use a Christian category on corporate media here tonight.
Well, yeah, or at the university that you teach, you probably don't want to use that either. Another sponsor, Pit Barrel Cookers. Pit Barrel cookers are awesome. There it is right there on the left. That's a Pit Barrel Classic created by Noah and Amber Glanville. Noah got back from the Middle East as a soldier with PTSD. He was treated, and his troop was treated with barbecue made by veterans, and he said, I'm home. I am home. See that food there? I did that. Mm-hmm. See those things up there on the middle of the screen above there? That's pork butt. I like pork butts, and I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. Below that, of course, is some nice brisket with white bread. Come on. Some spare ribs up there. There's a burger there. Pit Barrel cookers are amazing. About $300 for the big one. You hang the meat in there. You just set the temperature. You drop your charcoals in. There's a little vent that they say, you know, it has to be open this wide for this elevation. So no matter where you are, you can basically guarantee a constant temperature with real charcoal and real wood. PitBarrelCooker.com. PitBarrelCooker.com. It's a glorious beast. They got the Pit Barrel Classic there, and then, of course, the Pit Barrel Junior, a little bit smaller. Here we go. I'm back. Hey, hey, hey. Last story. This is pretty cool. Bionic girl. Tilly Lockey, diagnosed with meningitis when she was like just a few months old. She lost her arms. She was 15 months old. Diagnosed with meningitis. Lost both of her arms. There's this company that's making these astonishing, unbelievable prosthetics. Hero Arms. Hero Arms is what it's called. It's about 500 pounds per arm, which is what, about $8,000 per arm? That's pretty amazing. They're light, they're agile, and they allow her to live her life like someone who has her hands. And it's pretty cool. So we're going to wrap up the show with this wonderful person, Tilly Lockey and her bionic arms.
Hi, my name is Tilly and I'm 13 years old. I lost my hands to meningitis septicemia strain B when I was 15 months old. I was rushed to the hospital and they basically said that I was 100% going to die, and if I did manage to live, then I wouldn't be able to walk, run or do anything. There wasn't many prosthetics out there for kids when I was little because they couldn't manage to get the technology into such a small sized hand. So we kind of set out on a mission to try and make bionic hands that could fit kids as well as adults, because there just really wasn't anything to help. So I've recently got this brand new pair of bionic hands from the company Open Bionics, and they're amazing. I love them so much. They're 3D printed and really affordable, and this is what they do. You can go into a fist, you can do a thumbs up, you can go like that and pinch like that, and then you can also do that and that.
That's pretty cool. That is really cool. And basically, all she has to do is think about the desired movement, and the hero arms fingers spring to life. I thought you'd enjoy that. I just think it gives me hope for those who've lost limbs, for veterans who've come back and can't walk or don't have legs, don't have arms. I just think that the future is very bright, despite what Al Gore says. I really do. All right. Did you have fun? I had fun. Get a chance to go on Facebook. It's Rob Carson Show. I'm on a new radio station nationally. It's called Spoony.com, S-P-O-O-N-Y.com, and I'm launching a food podcast there. So we can disagree on politics. We might disagree there, but we won't disagree on ribs unless you're a vegan. If that's the case, you have an eating disorder. Order a T-shirt. Order something from tpublic.com/conservatives. I'd greatly appreciate it. My buddy, my designer, Sam Cangelosi, and I have put these together, and we're adding designs constantly. So if you'd order something, it would be a blessing. God bless you for joining me on The Range, okay? On The Range. Glad to be here. See you again soon. Have a great night.
Thanks for listening to The Rob Carson Show. Friend him on Facebook at Carson Show, on Twitter at Rob Carson, and on Instagram, I think Facebook and Twitter are enough for now.